Restrictive lung diseases represent a group of disorders characterized primarily by a reduction in lung volume, leading to decreased lung expansion and impaired gas exchange. These are distinct from obstructive lung diseases, which limit the outflow of air. Restrictive diseases, on the other hand, often result from conditions that make the lung tissue stiff or from external factors that prevent the lungs from fully expanding. This video breaks down the pathophysiology, clinical presentations, and management of the most common types of restrictive lung diseases. So if you're ready, let's get into it. As previously mentioned, restrictive lung disease is a category of respiratory disorders characterized by reduced lung volume and limited expansion. The issue can arise from stiff lung tissue or external constraints, which results in difficulty inhaling and reduced oxygen intake. Now, let's talk about the different types. First, we have pulmonary fibrosis. Pulmonary fibrosis is a condition where the lung tissue becomes scarred and thickened, reducing its ability to transfer oxygen to the bloodstream. This scarring can be due to various causes, including long-term exposure to certain toxins, radiation, medications, and certain lung diseases. The progressive scarring can lead to shortness of breath, a persistent dry cough, and fatigue. Number 2. Asbestosis. Asbestosis is a chronic lung disease caused by prolonged inhalation of asbestos fibers, often associated with occupational exposures. When these tiny fibers are inhaled, they can embed themselves in the lung tissue, causing inflammation, and eventually leading to fibrous scar tissue formation. Asbestosis manifests as shortness of breath, crackling sounds when breathing, and clubbing of the fingertips, progressing over time to more severe respiratory complications. Number 3. Sarcoidosis. Sarcoidosis is an inflammatory disease that can affect multiple organs in the body, but most commonly targets the lungs. It results in the formation of small granulomas in the affected tissues. The exact cause of sarcoidosis is unknown, but it's thought to be related to both genetic and environmental factors. Symptoms can range from mild to severe and might include shortness of breath, persistent cough, and chest pains. Number 4. Pleural effusion. Pleural effusion refers to the buildup of excess fluid between the layers of the pleura, the thin membranes lining the lungs and the inside of the chest wall. This accumulation can result from various conditions, such as heart failure, infections, malignancies, or trauma. The presence of this fluid can compress the lungs, causing shortness of breath, chest pains, and coughing. Number 5. Pneumothorax. Pneumothorax occurs when air leaks into the space between the lung and the chest wall, causing the lung to collapse. This can arise from a chest injury, certain medical procedures, or spontaneously in people with weakened lung tissue. Symptoms often include sudden chest pain and shortness of breath. In severe cases, it requires immediate medical attention. Number 6. Pleural tumors. Pleural tumors are abnormal growths that develop on the pleura. While some are benign, others, like malignant pleural mesothelioma, are cancerous and often linked to asbestos exposure. These tumors can cause chest pain, chronic cough, and dyspnea. Diagnosis often requires imaging studies and biopsy, and treatment options vary based on the type and the stage of the tumor. Number 7. Pulmonary edema. Pulmonary edema is the accumulation of fluid in the air sacs of the lung, often resulting from heart problems like left-sided heart failure. When the heart is unable to pump efficiently, blood can back up into the pulmonary veins, leading to fluid leakage into the lungs. This makes breathing difficult and can deprive the body of oxygen. Symptoms include shortness of breath, wheezing, and a feeling of suffocation, especially when lying down. Number 8. Chest wall trauma. Chest wall trauma refers to injuries that impact the chest area, such as rib fractures, bruising, or penetrating injuries. Such trauma can restrict lung expansion and compromise breathing. The causes range from motor vehicle accidents to falls or direct blows. Symptoms can include sharp pain, especially with breathing or coughing, bruising, and swelling. Severe trauma can lead to pneumothorax or hemothorax, which may require medical intervention. Number 9. Kyphoscoliosis. Kyphoscoliosis is a combined deformity where there's both outward and lateral curvature of the spine. This structural change in the spine can limit the space available for lung expansion, leading to restrictive lung disease. The severity of respiratory impairment depends on the extent of the spinal curvature. Patients might experience back pain, noticeable spinal deformity, and breathing difficulties, especially with extension. Number 10. Guillain-Barré Syndrome. Guillain-Barré Syndrome is a rare neurological disorder in which the body's immune system mistakenly attacks part of the peripheral nervous system. While primarily known for causing rapidly progressive muscle weakness, it can also affect the respiratory muscles, leading to breathing difficulties. Some patients with this condition may require mechanical ventilation due to the severity of respiratory muscle involvement. Number 11. Myasthenia Gravis. Myasthenia gravis is an autoimmune disease where antibodies attack the neuromuscular junctions, leading to muscle weakness and fatigue. This weakness can involve the respiratory muscles, causing shortness of breath and respiratory failure in severe cases. Symptoms tend to worsen over periods of activity and improve after rest. Number 12. Scleroderma. Scleroderma, or systemic sclerosis, is a chronic connective tissue disease characterized by the hardening and tightening of the skin and connective tissues. When it affects the lungs, it can lead to pulmonary fibrosis, pulmonary hypertension, and other respiratory complications. Shortness of breath, fatigue, and a dry cough are common respiratory symptoms associated with this condition. Number 13. Morbid Obesity. Morbid obesity refers to individuals who have a body mass index that's significantly above the normal range. Excessive body weight can place added pressure on the chest wall and diaphragm, restricting full lung expansion. This can lead to hypoventilation, decreased lung volumes, and diminished respiratory function. Common respiratory symptoms include shortness of breath with minimal exertion and sleep apnea. Now, let's talk about the treatment for restrictive lung diseases, which primarily focuses on addressing the underlying cause, managing symptoms, and improving the patient's quality of life. For diseases caused by environmental exposures, such as asbestosis, the primary approach is to prevent further exposure. This may include occupational changes or using protective equipment. For interstitial lung diseases with an inflammatory or autoimmune basis, like sarcoidosis or scleroderma, immunosuppressive medications such as corticosteroids or other immunomodulating agents are often prescribed. They help reduce inflammation and slow the progression of the disease. When fibrosis is significant, as in pulmonary fibrosis, antifibrotic agents can be used to decelerate disease progression. In cases where restrictive lung disease results from fluid buildup, like in pleural effusion or pulmonary edema, diuretics or therapeutic procedures to drain the fluid might be indicated. Pneumothorax, the presence of air in the pleural space, may require a chest tube insertion or surgery to remove the air and allow the lung to re-expand. For neuromuscular causes of restrictive lung diseases, like Guillain-Barré syndrome or myasthenia gravis, treatment may involve plasmapheresis, intravenous immunoglobulins, or medications to enhance neuromuscular transmission. When the disease involves chest wall abnormities, physical therapy can sometimes help improve breathing mechanics. In severe cases, surgery might be recommended to correct deformities. Oxygen therapy may be beneficial for those who have significantly reduced oxygen levels in their blood. This can help alleviate symptoms and improve overall well-being. Pulmonary rehabilitation, a comprehensive program that combines exercise training, education, and counseling, can be beneficial for many patients with restrictive lung diseases. It aims to enhance physical function, reduce symptoms, and improve the overall quality of life. In end-stage diseases or severe cases where other treatments are ineffective, lung transplantation may be considered as a last resort. However, keep in mind that it's imperative to emphasize that the optimal treatment plan for restrictive lung diseases often requires a multidisciplinary approach and should be individualized based on the patient-specific diagnosis, severity, and overall health. Regular monitoring and follow-ups with healthcare professionals are crucial to adjust treatments as needed and monitor for potential complications. So, as you can see, restrictive lung diseases pose significant challenges to respiratory function due to their limiting nature on lung expansion. Understanding their underlying causes and clinical manifestations is crucial for accurate diagnosis and tailored therapeutic interventions. Continued research and advances in treatment modalities offer hope for improved outcomes for patients. Awareness and early detection remain vital in mitigating the progression and complication of these diseases. If you want to support the channel, please like and subscribe. I would greatly appreciate it. And there should be some other helpful videos popping up on your screen right about now that I think you will enjoy. And just a quick reminder, we are not doctors. This video is for informational purposes only. Thank you so much for watching. Have a blessed day. And as always, breathe easy, my friend.